Fine, how are you? How's Rebecca? Yes, because, right, I saw that you were, I don't know which one of you all I'm friends with on Facebook, but I saw the picture, so.
And they started. Yes.
Yeah, the curved fingers thing, right?
Good morning. Welcome to First Presbyterian Church for Olympia Brown Unitarian Universalist Church Service. We'll have some announcements before we start. Orders of service and the song sheets are up here if you didn't get one. For those watching on YouTube, you can access the order of service in today's email where it says, click here for order of service. I want to thank Claire Cross for providing coffee hour today. I'm looking for 2 volunteers for next Sunday, so get in touch with me. Religious education needs juice boxes and snacks. If you would like to donate, please give them to Abby Summer here at church on Sunday mornings. Snacks need to be individually wrapped. The kids like Welch's fruit snacks, goldfish crackers, animal crackers, granola bars, etc. Thank you in advance for your donation. Also, if you would like to volunteer in IRE, talk with Abby. To former and current choir members who still have choir folders and music, Diana Pavao would very much appreciate it if you could get them to her either in church or at her home. Please contact her by phone or email. Her information is in the directory. You may have noticed the little library in the garden in front of Obuck on College Avenue. Violet Unger, one of our high school students, and some of her friends asked if they could put a banned books little library at church. The goal is to fill the little library with LGBTQ+ and banned books. Check it out and feel free to contribute. Teachers, please see Friday's email regarding free items you may be able to use in your classrooms. On September 5th and 6th, the Veterans for Peace will dock their sailboat, the Golden Rule, at the Reef Point Marina and will be met by an Indigenous color guard, Mayor Mason, and the Racine community. Programs will take place where the veterans discuss the increased dangers of nuclear war and the interesting history of the Golden Rule sailboat. There will be several opportunities to board the boat and speak with the crew. There will also be a dinner at Infusinos that you can join at your own expense. For further information about the schedule, see the weekly Unifier email, take one of these flyers, which I'll put over there, or contact Shirley Reynolds. And if you know of a place where you can post this, take one and do that. Oh, and this is co-sponsored by our Social Justice Committee. For more information and details about these announcements, along with others and community announcements, please see your weekly emails. Please join us for coffee hour in Nerman Hall following the service. For those joining us on YouTube, please log into Zoom after the service for joys and concerns, along with coffee hour. The link is in today's email.
When you wish upon a star, makes no difference who you are, anything your heart desires will come to you. If your heart is in your dream, no request is too extreme. When you wish upon a star, as dreamers do, fate is kind. It brings to those who love the sweet fulfillment of their secret longings. Like a bolt out of the blue, fate steps in to see you through. When you wish upon a star, your dreams come true.
Good morning. I love that. Welcome. Welcome to Olympia Brown Unitarian Universalist Church. I am the Reverend Danielle Lindstrom. My pronouns are she, her, hers, and it is good to be together. Let's start with just a big shared deep breath, just to fully arrive. Maybe we can practice being present to this moment, leaving the rest of the weekend in the past, right? Being here rather than thinking about our Sunday afternoon to-do lists, right? To be present together. Welcome, friends. Welcome new friends and old friends and our youngest friends and our online friends. Welcome. I share these words from our congregation in Boulder. In all the beauty of languages, cultures, skin tones, shapes, and sizes that come together in your uniqueness, you are welcome here. In all the ways you experience and express gender, you are welcome here. In the beauty that is who you love and how you love, you are welcome here. No matter how long you are away, nor how soon you will return, you are welcome here. Please do not leave your joys or your sorrows, pieces of your identity at the door. You are invited to bring all of it in here with you, for this is one of the promises of our faith tradition. All of who you are is welcome in our co-created and shared sacred space. It is good to be together. This morning, we are going to finish our conversation with our delegates from our General Assembly, which was the annual gathering of Unitarian Universalists. Kayla Matz and Carl Hubbard will be reflecting on their experience. And we will begin our service with shared ritual, lighting our chalice, which is the symbol of this faith tradition. And Sage will be lighting our chalice this morning. Our words by John Gibb Millspaugh and Sarah Gibb Millspaugh. Feel the love of the universe flowing through this community, into you and out into the universe. Let the love of all universe, your love, flow outward to its height, to its depth, to its broad extent. You are more than you know. You are more beloved than you know. Take up what power is yours to create safe haven, to make of earth a heaven. I invite you to rise in body and spirit. Brian, our music director, is going to lead us in a brand new chant hymn song, this coming to us, attributed to the anti-apartheid movement in South Africa. And I think we sang it quite a bit at General Assembly. I'm going to grab you a microphone. Is that okay? Do that.
All right. When I go like this, this is a call and response song. So I'll start, and when I go like this, you echo me. So we'll do it pretty simple. There is a part where we all sing together, and I'll teach you that first. So we'll do the call and response section first. So I'll go, Courage.
Courage.
My friend.
My friend.
And this is the part we'll all sing together. It goes like this. You do not walk alone. Try it with me. You do not walk alone. There's a second part. It goes like this. We will walk with you.
Walk with you.
And we sing together this. And sing your spirit home.
And sing your spirit home.
All right, let's put that together. Courage,
my friend.
You do not walk alone.
We will
walk with you.
And sing your spirit home.
Now, this song is what we call a zipper song, meaning we change out words and zip it all back together. So courage can be replaced by other things. It could be other abstract thoughts like love,
my friend.
You do not walk alone. We will walk with you and sing your spirit to home. We can also replace that abstract thought with a person in our mind that we want to let them know that they're not walking alone. So I'll just pick a name, Susan, and use that as an example. So, and we can think in our heads, picture this person in our thoughts as we sing the song for them. Susan,
my friend,
you do not walk alone. We will walk with you. And sing your spirit home. Is there anything or person that we would like to sing this to in our heads and hearts?
Jose.
Who?
Jose.
Jose. My friend. Do not walk alone. We will walk with you and sing your spirit home. We can also replace the word walk to be more able inclusive. Is there other ways we can be with people besides walking with them? Sit with them. Is there another person that we want to sing to with our heads and hearts? Vince.
My friend.
You do not sit alone. We will sit with you. And sing your spirit home. Another way we can be with somebody?
Dance.
Who can we dance with and for? People of Hawaii. Hawaii.
My friend. You do not dance alone.
We will dance with you and sing your spirit home. Let's do one more.
Farmers.
We'll start that the farmers to fit with the rhythm. And what can we do with the farmers? Work with them. All right.
Farmers, my friends,
you do not work alone. We will
work with you, and sing your spirit home.
And now it's time for the message for all ages. So if all the children and those young at heart want to come on forward. Yeah, you can't do that at the other building because there's carpet, huh? So this morning, I'm going to do a magic trick for you. So I have a quarter. I'm going to put the quarter in my hand, and I'm going to cover it. It is going to disappear. Like, when do you want to check and put your hand under there and make sure I didn't already take it away? Like, with my, put your hand under and touch it. Make sure, is there a quarter? Is there a quarter under there? There a quarter under there? You want to check, Ellie? You want a quarter? Quarter under there? Okay. Reverend Danielle, you want to check? Is there a quarter under there?
I think so, yeah.
Okay, so now I'm going to cover my hands over it three times. One, two, three. You didn't know I was that talented, did you? So now, should I make it reappear? Well, that's amazing, isn't it? Should I make it reappear? No. Do you think it's under there already? No, you want to check? Someone want to check? Someone who didn't check before, you want to put your hand under there and check? Make sure there's no quarter. No quarter. Anyone else check? Jacqueline, no quarter. No quarter. No trust issues, no quarter. Reverend Danielle, you want to check under there? Make sure there's no check under there. Okay, you ready? One, two, three.
Yeah, it's trust issues.
And the quarter's back. So the reason I showed you this magic trick is because we're talking about expectations today. What do you expect to happen when there's a quarter on my hand and I put a cloth? Do you expect it to disappear? No, you don't normally expect. We all know how the world works, right? And the world doesn't work that way. Things don't just disappear like that. So when you come to church on Sunday morning, what do you expect it to be like in here? Do you expect it to be loud? What do you expect, Ellie? Expect to sing songs, okay. Message for all ages. What do you expect the people to be like? Do you expect them to be kind? Mm-hmm. Can you think of other words that you expect the people in this church to be like? Nice, loving, thoughtful. Okay. So we have these expectations of what church is like. What if you came in here on Sunday morning, you came a little bit late, and you walked in, and Doug was playing this amazing music, and everyone, even all the adults out there, were standing up and dancing and raising their hands and whooping. Would that be what you expect? No, not at all. It might even make you feel uncomfortable, right? And some of the adults in here would probably be really uncomfortable. Because we don't expect that to happen. But some people would love it. Abby, she'd come in here and she'd be dancing because she'd love it. She wouldn't be uncomfortable at all, even though she didn't expect that to happen either. So sometimes people, and it wouldn't be a bad thing that everybody was dancing, right? Even if you felt uncomfortable, it's still not a bad thing. And even if you felt really happy about it, it's a great thing. So sometimes people do things that you don't expect them to do, right? And that's pretty normal. But because our community is a community of loving, kind people, we love each other anyway. Even if you walked in here and you felt really uncomfortable because everybody's dancing, you'd be looking over there and you'd be like, oh, but I still love that person. They're still kind to me other times. We wouldn't not like them anymore because they were acting that way, right? Because that's who we are as Unitarian Universalists, and that's who we are in this congregation. So do you want to know how I did the magic trick? Want me to show you how to do it so that you can do it at home? All right. So I put the coin in my hand, and I cover it up, and then you all check it. Don't look. Don't look. Just check it. Just check. And it's there. And then I go over, and then Ellie checks it, and whoever else wants to check it. I always go to Reverend Danielle as the last person, and she took the coin. You have to have you have to have an accomplice. So then, and then eventually she put it back. She was always the last person, and she put it back. That's how you do the trick. So now it's time for the children's blessing. That was the message for all ages. It was just a different one. Okay, everyone stand up. We'll do the children's blessing. Let's have Abby face this way, the kids, and I'll face this way. Ready? You can look at Abby if you don't know what you're doing. We are blessed. We are blessed by being. We are blessed by being here. We are blessed by being here together.
Nurture the spark of your precious life. We hold you in our love as you go.
There are many ways we give to the life of this church, and the monetary offering is just one of these ways. Each month, we partner with a local organization that is doing really great work in our community, and we share the money we gather. All of the different ways to give can be found on the back of your order of service. There's all kinds of different ways to give. Our partner for the month of August is Focus on Community. Focus on Community is dedicated to improving the lives of youth and families throughout Racine County. They spend time both in and outside of school with youth between 5th and 12th grade, teaching valuable life skills like goal setting, communication, and leadership. Any funds contributed to Focus on Community will help serve youth that are the core of our community. Thank you for all of the ways that you give. Thank you for your continued generosity.
Memories light the corners of my mind. Misty watercolored memories of the way we were. Scattered pictures of the smiles we left behind. Smiles we gave to one another for the way we were. Can it be that it was all so simple then? Or has time rewritten every line? If we had the chance to do it all again, tell me, would we? Could we? Memories can be beautiful and yet much too painful to remember. We simply choose to forget. So it's the laughter we will remember. Whenever we remember the way we were, the way we were, the way
part of being in community is sharing our lives with one another. During worship, we set aside special time for holding each other in love. And in this space, I invite you to participate in sharing in a way that is most comfortable for you. If you would like to come forward and light a candle, for whatever is on your heart, you are invited to come forward and light a candle. If you would like to share a joy or a sorrow out loud, I invite you to come forward to the pulpit or raise your hand and we can bring the microphone to you, remembering that we are streaming live to YouTube. If you would like to sit in shared quiet, listening to the breaths around you, the coughs, the rustling in the pews, your own silent meditation, time to pray or dream, you are invited to just be. If you will join me in words of attention, witness, and prayer, adapted from the words of Kate Bowler and Jessica Ritchie. For the ones who bear witness, blessed are the noticers, the ones who see the story in its fullness. Blessed are the attenders, the witness bearers, the story holders, the ones who tiptoe right alongside us, knowing that the very act will break their heart in pieces too, choosing us anyway. Blessed are those who are amazed by a life lived in its fragility, in its brevity, in its beauty. I invite you forward to light a candle or to say your joy or sorrow out loud.
Okay, I rarely talk. I usually just light candles, but I have just spent the past 3 days with a friend of mine that I met at the Midwest UU Summer Assembly, Musa's predecessor, like Geneva Summer Assembly. We met way back when we were kids, and we were there in the middle school and high school program, and we've been friends for 30 years because of a UU camp, and our families got together, and they drove here, and we had our kids playing, and this is someone who also has a connection here because her mom is a member of Reverend Danielle's former church. So it just felt like such a full circle UU moment. And this is why it matters to have UU kids and youth, because it impacts lives for generations.
There's lots of joys and sorrows in our life. My brother-in-law has surpassed 4 months of survival with his brain tumor, which some doctor said he wouldn't, and he's still pretty much with us. And last weekend, we went to the adventure park on Kenosha with his nieces and nephews, and so we're just celebrating every day as we have him.
I have a joy that I was in this sanctuary Friday night, filled with people and music. And it was wonderful. It was the season finale concert for Music and More, celebrating 30 years. And the man who started the program was here and performed with some of his family members, and they're all amazing.
I'd like to invite you all to the Root River Council Music in the Park next Saturday from 4 to 7. We're having the Celtic Gypsies, who are singing and doing Irish songs. This will be a special thing, and our parks are underused, and we want them to be a free and wonderful place for all people to build a better image of Racine. So please come and tell your friends. Thank you.
Let us light a candle and turn our hearts to our beloveds in Hawaii. And we will light one final candle for all of the joys, the sorrows that are on our hearts, that are on the hearts of those joining us on YouTube this morning. Their prayer continues. Blessed are those who are amazed by life lived in its fragility and its beauty. Behold that these are not problems to be solved. This is a person. These are people to be loved. This is the miracle we get to call by name. You are the miracle we get to call by name. And how lucky are we? These people, these loves, these precious, precious days. Thanks be to that which is larger than ourselves, the holy in all its complexity, however we name it. Will you join me in singing in the order of service? There is a love holding me, there is a love holding us.
Hello, I'm Kayla Matz. My pronouns are she, her, and I'm going to talk about my experience at General Assembly. So I grew up more or less unchurched, and so I hadn't really felt a feeling of inclusion and large oneness in a religious organization till attending here. And at General Assembly, this was heightened and expanded, which was so powerful and moving. There are few moments and seminars that are still in the forefront of my mind, so I wanted to share about three specific moments. One is kind of generally about being a Unitarian Universalist, and two about expectations that we all have. For the first one, I wanted to share some of the words spoken by the new UUA president, Reverend Dr. Sophia Betancourt. I was often covered in goosebumps from the power of her words. She spoke about the strong belief of unabashed grace, speaking to the inherent dignity and worth of all. I just keep thinking about that unabashed grace and how powerful that statement is. Through that week and after that talk, it began to really resonate to me that we truly are a faith group. It's a confusing thing sometimes to identify with. We are non-creedal, but our faith. Sometimes we all think about Unitarian Universalism as an interfaith group. What really became more solidified for me was that we are both. We can be an interfaith group, allowing all of us to have our individual belief in separate faiths outside of UU, but UU is also its own separate and distinct faith centered around this belief that we're all worthy just as we are. And I think there's a lot of power in being a faith, and it's easy to forget or lose that sometimes. Because I know I'm not alone in that my Unitarian Universalist faith leads me in how I interact with others, where I live, how I vote, how I raise my kids, and much, much more. It's harder to put a finger on how to describe this non-creedal faith, but I don't think it makes it any less powerful in our lives and doesn't take away how important Unitarian Universalism is as a faith group. So on to expectations. Reverend Dr. Sophia Betancourt also spoke about expectations that we put onto one another. She called us all to lower expectations of what others can do for us. Our culture has, as a whole, not just Unitarian Universalists, but as a whole, is really about the individual and putting that responsibility of wellness on each individual. I'd say one of the biggest takeaways for me from General Assembly was that we need to focus more on what's best for the greater whole, not just the individual. So let's all take steps away from individualism and look outward. Wellness is so important and is something that is unique to each person, but it's also important to look outward and consider how we allow or how we prevent others from resting and thriving. So some things that I thought about were, do we thank those that do service in our church? Do we thank everyone who works here? When something happens or needs to be done, who do we expect to volunteer? Do we allow people in our community to say no, thank you? Do we best support one another to allow each of us to thrive and rest? So Reverend Dr. Sophia Betancourt asked us all to send more thank you cards and share our gratitude with others, and use more community care to best allow all of us to have rest so that we all can thrive. Then the last moment or thing that really stuck with me was Carl and I attended a small seminar on youth and young adults in our spaces and in our faith. In this context, young adults refer to people under 25, maybe under 30, which I am not a part of, so just for some context. There was a lot of overlap with the seminar and about the expectations we put on others. The big takeaways were that we as Unitarian Universalist communities have a large bias against youth. And that was really difficult to hear. This was a seminar led by the youth in our faith. So let me kind of expand upon that and talk about that some more. The collective we don't respect the inherent worth and dignity of young people. And I'm using the word we to mean the collective Unitarian Universalist communities. So this is definitely not about Leanne or Reverend Danielle or Abby or any of the RE volunteers. This is more of a thing about how we view children and young people in our spaces and how we bring them into our faith. So when I use that we, now using that collective we of Unitarian Universalist communities as a whole, we admire young people's passion and heart, but we often don't respect their voices when they don't agree with the collective us. We say we want them to come to service and be a part of our communities, but when our spaces aren't comfortable for them or not at a time that works well for them, we don't change to accommodate. Young people are passionate, they are change makers, they ask difficult questions, but, and, these things are so necessary, and if we want to continue to grow as individuals, we need young people to learn from. So the organizers recommended we all, everyone 30 and older, find a mentor younger than 30 years old to learn from and grow with them. So kind of back to expectations. They also mentioned that we expect them to join our spaces, not join theirs, with the added expectations that they do things our way. Young people can be loud, chatty, and wiggly. They can be in the aisles. They are always hungry. They are continuously growing and changing and transforming, and all of these things are sacred. Being loud as a child is sacred. Being in the aisle dancing is sacred. Sharing your voice and opinions is sacred. The UU youth are calling all of us to include them as their full selves in all of our spaces, and they are calling us to join them in new spaces and allow them to be who they are. So when we expect young people to fill a role of seen but not heard, and when young people are only invited into our spaces so that we can educate them, we are not respecting their worth just as they are. So to summarize, let's all go write thank you letters to our volunteer leaders and our amazing staff. Number two, let's look outward at our expectations of others. Number 3, let's join young people and youth in our shared faith. 4, let's always remember to feed the youth. And lastly, 5, let's all go find new mentors that are 30 and younger. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Carl Harbert, as you know. And my pronouns are he, him, and his. The Writing Center at the College of St. Rose defines a dangling modifier as a word or phrase that does not clearly refer to a specific subject. Such is the case with the title or theme of the 2023 General Assembly, Faithfully Becoming. Like any good English major, that dangling modifier really concerned me. Faithfully becoming what? I wondered. I arrived at GA, anticipating that I'd find out more about what it is that we, as individual Unitarian Universalists and as UU congregations, are supposed to be faithfully becoming. Here's a little about my 2023 GA experience. The music was awesome, with amazing and inspiring choir performances, and soloists. GA provided many important workshops on environmental stewardship, diversity, and inclusion, including those I attended myself on LGBTQIA and anti-racist practices. Also, I learned a lot about Article 2 and how it came into being. I also listened to many speakers concerned about replacing the more specific language of the Eighth Principle with the love-centered language of the Article 2 proposal. This is a concern I share. I witnessed the frustration and disappointment of those mostly young people who proposed the business resolution requesting complete divestment from the fossil fuel industry and subsequent reparations. As previous delegates have shared with you, that resolution failed by a 60-40 margin. Disappointing. I will share with you the reasons why the UUA General Assembly and Board of Directors opposed it. The UUA board opposes the business resolution, complete divestment from the fossil fuel industry, and subsequent reparations, which was submitted by petition because it would undermine the UUCEF's current values-based work on climate action and other human rights issues, close off the conversations we need to have about UU values and investments, preempt the work the board has begun around reparations, and directly cut the UUA budget. I think those words fell on deaf ears to the many young people who are less concerned about our financial well-being than they are about their future and ours. I saw evidence at GA that even within a spiritual community as diverse and progressive as Unitarian Universalism, systemic racism and supremacist ideas are still sometimes voiced. There were 2 GA delegates who spoke about, quote, the myth of white supremacy, and how, quote, white supremacy ideas are what made America great. Ever hear 2,000 plus Unitarians simultaneously gasp in disapproval? There was also the instance where an African-American delegate in an anti-racist workshop was asked not to join a breakout discussion group by white participants who explained that they would be more comfortable without them there. Despite Reverend Danielle's many wonderful sermons encouraging us to think hopefully, optimistically, even joyfully about where we are going and what we are becoming, both as individuals and as a church, I am not a natural optimist. I very much needed to hear the powerful, uplifting music and the words of the religious leaders and speakers who shared their thoughts on becoming more loving, more inclusive, more committed to advocacy and justice. In particular, speakers like Reverend Manish Mishra Marzetti and the Ware lecturer, Dr. Imani Perry. They were exemplary. I still don't have the answer to faithfully becoming what, but I am deeply grateful to this congregation for sending me there as your delegate. My 5 days at the 2023 GA helped me to realize that faithfully becoming what we most need to be requires greater awareness of what the world we live in most needs us to be. Perhaps less inclined to complacency about the moral and political bad things happening all around us, and more committed to work for a safe, just, and sustainable future. Failing that, faithfully becoming devolves into what becomes of us.
Thank you so much for sharing, Kayla and Carl. And darn it, Carl, you're right. I am such an optimist. I was like, yes, we are faithfully becoming. You made me think about what? What does that mean? So I thought about it. And it brought to mind a caterpillar in a cocoon. We are naming what we know is true. We are not where we were, especially pre-pandemic, but we aren't where we are going either. We are still figuring out what religious and spiritual community looks like in this time and in this space. So I guess that means we're in the goo phase, where, according to Scientific American, a caterpillar disintegrates all of its tissues except its imaginal discs, which use protein-rich soup to remind and fuel the cells to do the work of creating the adult butterfly or moth, scientifically called the goo phase. We're going to push this metaphor a little bit, so just kind of go with me here, okay? So we're in this goo phase. We're not quite butterflies, or we're moths. We're not even sure if we are a butterfly or a moth. But we have these imaginal discs, the information center. We have our history, our roots, our hard-earned lessons, our shared experiences to support the transition that is taking place. A lot has to develop in this goo phase. There is so much potential in the protein-rich soup. Isn't that an image?
What is waiting to emerge, to become for us as a faith tradition? And part of this goo phase, I'm just seeing how many times I can say that in a sermon. Part of this goo phase, there's another, isn't only imagining what is possible, but there is an undoing, becoming undone from a caterpillar into the goo. In what ways can we, should we, do we as a faith community need to become undone? When I first became a Unitarian Universalist, it was fairly common to say, UUs are great because you can believe whatever you want. Have we heard that? We're great because you can believe whatever you want. It's a really simple way to try to get at the heart of a truly complex idea. We hold covenant at our center, that we can be in deep spiritual relationship with one another, even if theologically we have different understandings of the holy, of that which is larger than ourselves, or of the human spirit, however we name it. We believe what we want is certainly easier to say, but is it true? Right. Dr. Takiya Amin is a scholar, educator, strategist, and has been a board member of Black Lives of Unitarian Universalism. She offers us a reminder of the fourth principle, the free and responsible search for truth and meaning, and this is heard a few different ways in our congregations. The free and responsible search for truth and meaning. The free and responsible search for truth and meaning. The free and responsible search for truth and meaning. Right? What word didn't get emphasized? Did we catch it?
Responsible.
She offers that while, yes, our big tent philosophy, our all our welcome philosophy is important, but it needs nuance. It's okay to say if that you are not living or trying to live into our covenant after being welcomed back time and time again, or if you are cruel, or if you are causing harm, or if you are refusing to listen to someone's stories or refusing to acknowledge someone's full humanity, that you are not welcome here. There are beliefs, ideas, positions that are not welcome here. And these are never easy conversations to have. But you cannot believe whatever you want. This is disrespectful to a tradition that sees spiritual nourishment and growth as intricately connected to working for justice. You cannot have spiritual growth without justice, not as a Unitarian Universalist. And you cannot do the work of justice without growing in the process as a Unitarian Universalist. Perhaps we are folks who love what it means to have a free search for truth and meaning, but overlook the word responsible, because responsible would call us into uncomfortable truths about who we are, who we welcome, who we assume is present, who we assume we are better than, who we have outthought or out-theologized, just not a word. Reverend Dennis McCarty explains it this way, quote, "We need courage to use precise language. Homophobia, transphobia, Islamophobia, ableism, racism, white privilege, white supremacy, institutional racism, to dispel the dominant culture's comfortable vagueness." To dispel dominant culture's comfortable vagueness. Say what we mean and mean what we say. And this isn't an intellectual exercise, right? This church, this Unitarian Universalism is not an intellectual exercise. I have heard this many times in many places. So if you have said this to me, I promise I am not picking on you. This comes up a lot in our Unitarian Universalist spaces, right? We hear, I come to church to be intellectually challenged. I have spent many long Saturday nights trying to make sure that my sermons have a sense of intellectual depth, knowing that I will miss the mark because I don't know what that means. A comfortable vagueness around what we need, right? That's what that feels like, a vagueness around what is it that we actually need? What do we seek? What do we hope for? This is more than an intellectual exercise. This church has to be more than an intellectual exercise. It is work of the heart. It is being reminded and reminding each other of our connection. It is letting go. Ready? It is letting go of the consumerist idea that we can come to church to get something out of it. As if we can take from this community without also offering our hearts and our minds care to one another and still are somehow participating in it. Can we let go of that idea that we are here to take from? Right? Part of our creation, this phase of imagination, is to wonder what it looks like to be and know ourselves to be co-creators of this church. To know that it is our job collectively to make the church possible, that my role is to offer guidance and support and care and ideas, but it is our work together that makes this community. We are called to spiritual growth not only through ideas, right, but through stories and poetry and music and witness and action and deep, honest sharing. And practicing trust, practicing curiosity, practicing love, hope, courage. Because if we can't do it here, how do we do it out there? So much, this and so much more come together to make this incredible, beautiful space possible. So let's embrace the goo phase for a while. Who knows what will happen when we emerge? Maybe then, Carl, we will have an answer to what we are faithfully becoming. Though butterflies have an average lifespan of 2 to 4 weeks. So if we follow this metaphor all the way through to the end, once we become, once we feel we know who we are for the moment, we then have the chance, the opportunity, the necessity to start the process all over again. And maybe this time we start this process as ancestors, making up the imaginal discs for the future of our faith. Maybe. Just maybe. Amen and blessed be. I invite you to rise in body and spirit. Join in singing the hymn that is in your order of service. Brian is going to lead us. Life calls us on.
Just because I'm holding the mic doesn't mean I don't want you to sing. I want you to sing with me, especially in the chorus, please.
Here in reverence now we gather for the blessings we have known with a pledge to one another. That we journey not alone. Joy and sorrow make us wise. Kin to all that lives and dies, love calls us on. Love calls us on. Words and deeds of those before us waken here to keep us strong. Blend our voices in the chorus of creation's living song. Courage bids us lift our eyes upward to the shining skies. Hope calls us on. Hope calls us on. Loyal guides in love and duty, leads us with a trusted light. Blessed are they whose windward beauty shows the path of truth and right. Honor is their earthly prize. By their work we realize faith calls us on. Faith calls us on. We have shared a radiant tower when the truth has made us free. And the Spirit's gracious power dreamed of good that yet shall be. Bright the path before us lies. Joyful pilgrims now we rise. Life calls us on. Life calls us on. Life calls us on. Life calls us on. Two more times. Life calls us on. Life calls us on. Life calls us on. Life calls us on.
Thank you. You may be seated. We are going to extinguish our chalice and close with this poem by Padraig O Tuama, The Facts of Life. That you were born and you will die. That you will sometimes love enough and sometimes not. That you will lie if only to yourself. That you will get tired. That you will learn most from the situations you did not choose. That there will be some things that move you more than you can say. That you will live and you must be loved. That you will avoid questions most urgently in need of your attention. That life isn't fair. That life is sometimes good and sometimes better than good. That life is often not so good. That life is real, and if you can survive it well, survive it well, with love and art and meaning given when meaning's scarce. That you will learn to live with regret. That you will learn to live with respect. that the structures that constrict you may not be permanently constricting, that you will probably be okay, that you must accept change before you die, but you will die anyway. So you might as well live, and you might as well love. You might as well love. You might as well love. Our worship is over. Our service begins. Go forth sharing this love, sharing your light with all you meet until we return again.
Bows and flows of angel hair and ice cream castles in the air. Feather canyons everywhere. I've looked at clouds that way, but now they only block the sun. They rain and snow on everyone. So many things I would have done, but clouds got in my way. I've looked at clouds from both sides now, from up and down, and still somehow it's cloud illusions I recall. I really don't know clouds at all. Moons and Junes and Ferris wheels, the dizzy dancing way you feel, as every fairy tale comes real, I've looked at love that way. But now it's just another show. You leave them laughing when you go. And if you care, don't let them know. Don't give yourself away. I've looked at love from both sides now, from give and take, and still somehow it's love's illusions I recall. I really don't know love at all. Tears and fears and feeling proud to say I love you right out loud. Dreams and schemes and circus crowds, I've looked at life that way. But now old friends are acting strange. They shake their heads, they say I've changed. Well, something's lost, but something's gained in living every day. I've looked at life from both sides now, from win and lose and steal somehow. It's life's illusions I recall. I really don't know life. I've looked at life from both sides now, from up and down, and still somehow it's life's illusions I recall. I really don't know life at all.